Well, we are starting a new sermon series today. We got through the seven I Am statements of Jesus, and this series should take us through the month of April, maybe a little bit into May, because we have some guest speakers coming up later this month. But this is the last book of the Old Testament, so it's fairly easy to find, unlike some of the other minor prophets. There are just four chapters in this book, and I'm hoping that we can make our way through it in four Sundays. That would be the plan. But let's open our Bibles this morning and jump right into Malachi chapter 1, page 1487, if you're using the church Bible there in front of you. Otherwise, in your own Bible, let's turn to Malachi chapter 1, and we're going to read that entire first chapter. An oracle, the word of the Lord to Israel through Malachi. I have loved you, says the Lord, but you ask, how have you loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, the Lord says? Yet I have loved Jacob, but Esau I have hated, and I have turned his mountains into a wasteland and left his inheritance to the desert jackals. Edom may say, though we have been crushed, we will rebuild the ruins. But this is what the Lord Almighty says. They may build, but I will demolish. They will be called the wicked land, a people always under the wrath of the Lord. You will see it with your own eyes and say, great is the Lord even beyond the borders of Israel. A son honors his father and a servant his master. If I am a father, where is the honor due me? If I am a master, where is the respect due me? Says the Lord Almighty. It is you, O priests, who show contempt for my name. But you ask, how have we shown contempt for your name? You place defiled food on my altar. But you ask, how have we defiled you? By saying that the Lord's table is contemptible. When you bring blind animals for sacrifice, is that not wrong? When you sacrifice crippled or diseased animals, is that not wrong? Try offering them to your governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you, says the Lord Almighty? Now implore God to be gracious to us. With such offerings from your hands, will he accept you, says the Lord Almighty? Oh, that one of you would shut the temple doors so that you would not light useless fires on my altar. I am not pleased with you, says the Lord Almighty, and I will accept no offering from your hands. My name will be great among the nations, from the rising to the setting of the sun. In every place, incense and pure offerings will be brought to my name, because my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord Almighty. But you profane it by saying of the Lord's table, it is defiled, and of its food, it is contemptible. And you say, what a burden, and you sniff at it contemptuously, says the Lord Almighty. When you bring injured, crippled, or diseased animals and offer them as sacrifices, should I accept them from your hands, says the Lord? Cursed is the cheat who has an acceptable male in his flock and vows to give it, but then sacrifices a blemished animal to the Lord. For I am a great king, says the Lord Almighty, and my name is to be feared among the nations. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of God endures forever. Well, as I said, this is the last of the Old Testament prophets. We really don't know a lot about Malachi, or as one of my seminary profs used to say, Malachi, the Italian prophet. But let me take a few moments just to provide you with some introduction to this book. Malachi is prophesying roughly 70 to 100 years after the return of the Jews from exile, and roughly that period of time since Zechariah, the prophet who precedes him in the Old Testament. So this is about 400, maybe 430 years before Christ. The Jews are now back in Israel following their 70 years of captivity in Babylon, and Jerusalem with its walls, with the temple, have been rebuilt under the leadership of Ezra and Nehemiah, Joshua and Zerubbabel. But as the Jewish people have settled back into their homeland, they have also settled into a very comfortable attitude towards the Lord, an apathy. A kind of lukewarmness has come over them, and a religiosity has begun to set in. They're religious in practice, but they are cold in heart. They're filled with empty profession, with self-righteousness, with hypocrisy. That led, over the next couple of hundred years, to the formation of some groups, some sects, S-E-C-T-S, just so you make sure you got that right, within Judaism, known as the Pharisees, familiar group of people to us, also the Sadducees. And Jesus condemned those groups for their hypocrisy, for their lack of true love for God and for other people. Maybe that accounts for the fact that the period between the Old and the New Testaments is known as the silent period. The intertestamental period is the silent period because there was a silence of God's prophetic voices. It's not that God didn't want to speak to his people. He did, and he was trying, but they weren't listening. Now, lest we get too critical of these people, we really need to look honestly at ourselves. I mean, I don't know about you, but I know that it is easy for me to become comfortable, even to become apathetic, to not listen to God as well as I know I should. All of us face the great danger of that, and it is a great danger indeed. Most preachers and Bible scholars today suggest that here in the church in North America, at least, we live in an era that is characterized by spiritual apathy and lukewarmness. I think it was Francis Schaeffer who said that American Christianity is in a post-Christian era. That is to say, vibrant, dynamic Christianity is dead, it is gone, it is behind us. And he said that because so much of the church, in his estimation and his observation, was involved in religious dress, going through the motions, looking to ordain those whom God clearly had forbidden to ordain, and relaxing the truth and the morality of God's word. America is certainly in a state very much like that of Malachi's day. So this is a very relevant book for us to look at today. Well, the name Malachi means, literally, my messenger. There are just 55 verses in the entire book, and interestingly, 47 of those verses are spoken directly by God in the first person. Now, all of Scripture is the words of God. Let's be clear about that. But as far as a direct revelation to one of the biblical writers that is given in the first person, Malachi has the highest percentage of any writer of the Old Testament and possibly the New as well. Clearly, God gave this message, this book, to Malachi, and he is truly a messenger of the Almighty. God uses Malachi to speak directly to those attitudes of religiosity, of hypocrisy, that were beginning to form and to take root in Israel. And God wants to use Malachi, I believe, to speak to some of those same kinds of attitudes that exist in the church today. It begins immediately in verse 2 with God saying, "I have loved you." But apparently, in their increasing distance from a warm and a heartfelt relationship to God, many of the Jews are questioning if it's true. I mean, does God really love us? And they ask, "How have you loved us?" That would be like saying in contemporary terms, "God, what have you done for me lately?" That brings us to the second part of the first chapter here, about Jacob and Esau, verses 2-5. God answers this charge of the Jews of not loving them by pointing back to these twin sons of the patriarch Isaac, Jacob and Esau. If you remember the story, God chose Jacob, who was later, you'll recall, renamed Israel, to receive his covenant blessing instead of his brother Esau, who was born first, by the way. And here he's going to talk about that sovereign electing love that he has for his people. Paul discusses this whole thing in one of the more difficult chapters in Romans. And I want to have us turn to that a moment to see what Paul says there. Because Paul is deriving what he says in Romans chapter 9 from what Malachi says, as well as the original count back in Genesis chapter 25. So let's look at a few verses, chapter 9 of Romans, verses 10 to 16. Not only that, but Rebekah's children had one and the same father, our father Isaac. Yet before the twins were born or had done anything good or bad, in order that God's purpose in election might stand, not by works but by him who calls, she was told, the older will serve the younger. Esau will serve Jacob. Just as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. It does not, therefore, depend on man's desire or effort, but on God's mercy. Now, let me make it clear, because I think there is some confusion about this, that when Scripture says, Esau I have hated, it doesn't mean that God literally hated Esau. God loved Esau, just as he loved Jacob and all of the rest of the descendants of Father Abraham. The term hated, as it is used here, only means that God chose Jacob instead of Esau to inherit the covenant promises, the blessing given to Abraham and Isaac, to be the lineage through whom the Messiah would eventually come. That's what it means. God's rejection of Esau doesn't have anything to do with the possibility of Esau's salvation, of his eternal destiny. God wanted Esau and all of his children to know him, to love him, to serve him, and to have his blessings as much as anyone. But here in this text, God is reminding his people, look, I have chosen you. I did not choose Esau. Even though he was the oldest and legally he may have been entitled to the blessing, but I chose you instead. I made you my people. And God says, I have loved you. You just don't acknowledge it. And we can have that same problem too, can't we? And I think part of the problem is that we gripe on both sides of this. We wrestle, many of us, we wrestle with this whole idea of God's election. And we say, well, that's not fair. How come he loved Jacob and he hated Esau? Especially when we think that things in our lives are kind of going as badly as they did for Esau, and life isn't being fair, and we're maybe wrestling with a sense of condemnation of God or something, we might raise our fists angrily towards heaven and accuse God of hating us, just like Esau did. But then, on the other hand, if we're walking closely with God, but we just don't sense that we're being blessed the way that we think we should be, we might start looking around at other brothers or sisters in Christ around us and say, as Esau said of Jacob, well, why should that guy be more blessed than me? I mean, he's a conniving cheat. That's not fair. Charles Spurgeon once said, the real marvel of this story isn't that God hated Esau, it's that he loved Jacob. And you know what? I am so glad that God loves Jacobs, because I'm a Jacob. I am an unworthy sinner who falls short of the glory of God. You know what? You're a Jacob. You're a Jacob. God loves you. The next thing that God does here is he traces Esau's lineage to the Edomites. Did you know that? That Esau was the father of the Edomites? Jacob became the father of the Israelites. Esau became the father of the Edomites, which, if you can see that map, it's maybe not real clear, was to the south and a little bit to the east of Israel. The red line at the top is pointing towards Jerusalem and the area of Israel. The red line at the bottom is pointing to that territory, which is now modern-day Jordan, by the way, and parts of Saudi Arabia, but it was down below the Dead Sea. The lineage of Jacob, again, Israel, he was renamed, was the 12 tribes, right? It was the 12 sons of Jacob. And they are still in God's favor at this time because, listen, the covenants of God are irrevocable. They are unchangeable. And the lineage of Esau, likewise, is still in disfavor with God because the Edomites were a perennial enemy of the Jews, just like Esau was an ongoing enemy of his brother Jacob. Now, today, Edom no longer exists as a nation, but it represents all of those who stand as enemies to Israel, in opposition to Israel. And God says in verse 4, whatever the Edomites build, I will tear it down. That is to say, people are not going to succeed in building a kingdom that will stand against my chosen people. Now, that's what teachers and Bible scholars have today keep telling us, and they keep trying in various ways to communicate to our government leaders, don't mess with Israel. Don't go against those whom God has chosen. It will not go well for you if you do. But here, God is reminding the Jews, look at your history. Look at how I have provided for you, how I have protected you. Yes, you've been chastened because I chasten those I love. I discipline my children. But in spite of that, you have been blessed. You have been cared for more than any other nation. I mean, look at where you are today. You have been restored to your land. The temple has been rebuilt. Jerusalem has been restored. Why are you complaining? You are blessed. Look at what's going on in Edom. Things really aren't that bad for you. And friends, I think that that is an allegory for us here in America today. We have been immeasurably blessed. Amen? But I hear many people, including many Christian people, gripe and complain all the time. That's a whole other sermon, so I won't go there. We need to press on today. But it brings us to these charges that God wants to bring against the people of Malachi's day. So let's move along to verses 6 to 14, which is all about unacceptable sacrifices. God begins by saying, a son honors his father and a servant his master. So apparently this was a time when sons and servants really did honor and give respect to fathers and to their masters. And we're living in a time when I don't know that we can say that is true. But God asks the Jews, if I'm a father to you, where is my honor? I mean, if I am your Lord, if I'm the master over the house of Israel, where is the respect that is due to me? And he levels this charge against the priests of Israel for despising him, for showing him contempt. And for those of you who might say, well, I'm sure glad this passage doesn't apply to me because Malachi is just talking to the priests, not so fast. Doesn't Peter say in 1 Peter 2:9, you are a chosen nation, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. We are all priests today, so this applies to all of us. But again, the priests have adopted this kind of ignorant, maybe naive innocence that would say, what do you mean, Lord? What do you mean? I mean, how have we shown contempt for you? God says, well, you offer defiled food on my altar. He's talking about the sacrificial altar, not like a communion table, didn't have those yet, the table of sacrifice in the temple. And we need to understand the background here. In the law of Moses, God had commanded the Israelites, whenever they came to worship him with their sacrifices, to bring the best of their flocks, to bring the best of their fields and the produce of their orchards and whatnot. And if they did that, God says, I will bless you because you appropriately acknowledge that I'm worthy and you bring the honor to me that I deserve. But now God sees the Jews of this time making their offerings and bringing their sacrifices, and he says, you are not bringing me your best. I am not only not honored, I'm dishonored. I'm offended at what you give me. And in doing that, you despise me, you show contempt for me. You're not even showing the most basic honor of a son to a father or an employee to a supervisor. You're not even giving me that much. Clearly, it's not only about the attitude that's involved, because it's about the real sacrifices. It's about the lambs and the wheat or whatever they were bringing. But it all begins in the heart, right? That's what Jesus said. It all begins in the heart, because God is more interested in the heart than he is in a dead animal or something else. By way of example, a Jewish man might have a lamb that was blind. He'd say, well, I might as well bring this lamb to the temple. The dumb thing can't see where it needs to graze anyway, and it's probably just going to walk off some cliff, and I'm going to lose it anyway. I'll just take it to the temple. Or he would find some animal along the road that had been run over by a chariot. It was still alive. We would call it roadkill, but it couldn't be dead yet. So, and he'd say, well, hey, I'll just bring this. You know, then I don't have to take one out of my herd. Still good enough. But the problem wasn't just the offering itself. The bigger problem, as I mentioned, was in the heart, that they would even consider bringing God such a despicable offering. I mean, it was literally and figuratively a lame offering. And the question every single one of us needs to ask ourselves today in response to this text is, what kind of offering am I bringing to God? Do I give him my best? If we're going to be faithful to this text, we have to ask ourselves the same question that God asks the Israelites. With the kind of offerings that you are making, should I accept them? Do you think God should bless you if you are not keeping the most basic of his requirements to honor him as your heavenly Father? The NIV says here, is that not wrong? And I read it in the King James Version, then I checked the original, the meaning of the original, and the King James has it closer to what the original means. It renders it, is that not evil? And I have to admit to you that I have never, up until this week when I studied this text, I have never thought of me failing to give God what he deserves in terms of my tithes and offerings as something that would be evil. That's what it says. Now in verse 12, God says that doing this actually profanes his name. So think about this. Failing to give God the offering that he deserves to receive is just as bad as cursing and taking his name in vain. God says, try doing this kind of thing with your governor, with the IRS. Try doing this with regard to your taxes. See how that goes for you. In verse 10, he says, oh, that one of you would shut the temple doors so that you would not light useless fires on my altar. In other words, you know, I would rather just have you close the church altogether than to continue bringing me these despicable, offensive offerings. Folks, these are some of the strongest words of the Lord anywhere in the New Testament, or in the Old Testament. It's just right between the eyes. This has to do not merely with our tithes, with our financial offerings, but really with all of our worship, with all of our serving in the church. And don't you know that it's more than that? It has to do with our whole lives. Our whole lives. As believers in Jesus Christ, you and I are called to give God the best that we can give all the time in everything we do. Romans 12:1 says that our entire lives should be a living sacrifice to the Lord. And that means that we should strive to be the best parents, the best grandparents, the best spouses, the best students, the best employees, the best neighbors, the best everything. People should be able to look at our lives and say, you know, you really amaze me. You do so many things well. I mean, I just so admire your generosity, your positive attitude, your initiative, your care for other people, your pursuit of holiness and perfection. I don't know how you do it. And there you go. That's your opportunity. That's the wide open door to say, well, let me tell you how I do it through the strength of Jesus Christ, my Lord, because I'm telling you, it ain't me, right? Our whole lives testify to the grace of God. And as God closes the book on the Old Testament, on his revelation to the Old Covenant, isn't it wonderful how he makes our life purpose so clear here in this passage? In verse 11, my name will be great among the nations, he says, from the rising to the setting of the sun. In every place, incense and pure offerings will be brought to my name. Friends, that is God's purpose for our lives, for your life and mine. That is God's purpose for Fifth Reformed Church. And that is not done merely with the words that we sing and speak here on Sunday mornings. It is done every single hour of every single day. It's done through the offerings that we make. Certainly with our treasure, with our money, but also with our time, with our talent, with all that God's given to us. Now, I really didn't set out to make this a stewardship message. I just wanted to preach on an Old Testament prophet. In fact, one of my preacher friends said, don't preach about stewardship in April. People will think you're trying to get their tax refund. I didn't set out to make it a stewardship message, but I guess, hey, you can't argue with God. I think that's what God wanted it to be. And that's okay. But let me tell you what is not okay is for us to give God less than he's worthy of. To give him less than our best. And to think that somehow that doesn't grieve his heart as much today as it did back in Malachi's day. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. It still grieves his heart. Do you know that God has given you his best? He gave you heaven's best in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. And that should tell you that God is far more interested in your heart and in your life than he is in your money, in your wallet or your purse. He doesn't ask for much, really. I mean, if you think about this, you know, one day out of seven as a Sabbath to him, one-tenth, just one-tenth of your income. And we'll talk about tithing in a few weeks when we get to that, because that's in Malachi as well. But in all of this, he just wants us to obey. Because what does Scripture say? To obey is better than a sacrifice, right? To obey is better than sacrifice. To obey is to demonstrate our love for him. So let's think about these things. Let's really meditate on these things and say, Lord, am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing when it comes to my offerings? What would you have me do, Lord? I'm ready to obey because it's all about the greatness of your name. It's all about the glory of your name. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for your word to us today. Thank you for your servant Malachi, your messenger, through whom you spoke a very direct, very difficult, a very challenging word. And Lord, it is a word for us today as well. We need to trust you, Lord, in your request to bring you our highest and our best, to not give you the leftovers, but to give you the first fruits of all that you have given to us. So Lord, we want your blessing, but we know that you can't bless disobedience. So we're asking, Lord, you to help us by the power of your Holy Spirit to obey you in this and to trust you with our heart and soul and mind and strength. Lord, hear our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.